Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain.
Welcome to the North Georgia three-day event. We're at Bouchard Farms in Chatsworth, North Georgia. Over the next 2 days, we'll be setting you sweet with an overview of the vet check, which ensures the utmost safety, and digging a bit of the dressage, cool, mellow, control, and obedience, like never before seen communication between man and animal. Let us not forget our live and extremely intense coverage of the cross country, phase D of the Endurance Day for those of you keeping score. By the time the competitors get to the vet box for reinspection of soundness, their team of horse and rider have traveled over 10 miles. We'll hear their plans as they set out and attack another 2 miles with over 30 jumping efforts. Talk about getting out of hand. We're running at a full click, jumping and a bouncing, banging and a booming. Don't let the sound of thunder scare you. Look out! It's Sunday and time for a third and final look at the horse. We'll see who has prepared and conditioned themselves and their horse well enough to make it to the final phase, stadium jumping. Another 15 jumping efforts lie ahead. Each rail here will cost you 5, and you better hurry. The pressure is on. The penalty points mount, and riders drop in the standings. A true test of courage and responsibility. Check it out. The competitors, they're all 21 and under. Hey man, where do you think you're going? You don't want to miss the 1992 preliminary three-day event National Young Rider Championships. Live from Bouchard Farm in Chatsworth, North Georgia. Buckle your seatbelts. We'll return to North Georgia with the start of our competition right after this. We're here at Bouchard Farms in Chatsworth, North Georgia. I'm Paul Leshinsky, and along with Ralph Hill, we'll be bringing you all the action from the 1992 National Young Riders Championships. The competitors right now are getting ready to begin their endurance day. And Ralph, as the first competitors are heading out towards Phase A, why don't you tell us a little bit about what goes on in the first three phases?
Well, Phase A is just traveling at a trot, 220 meters per minute from point A to point B. And it's just to loosen you up and get you ready for Phase B, which is the steeplechase phase. And this is a really great phase because it's testing out the speed of the horse as riders. It gets you relaxed and settled in. You jump about 8 jumps. Then you go right out on the Phase C, which is another endurance test at a trot from point A to point B. And it also gives the horse time to recover.
Well, we have a little time here before our first riders start coming back into the box. We had some lousy weather here Wednesday with a lot of rain, and on Thursday we had our first vet inspection. And what goes on here, Ralph?
Well, we have a panel, a ground jury, that watches the horses. As you can see, they're being presented by the riders. And they watch them jog forward and back, and they test to see if the horse is serviceably sound to start the competition. And you can see it's on very firm footing, which we don't train our horses on.
Well, all these kids are obviously very young and have spent, months of preparation getting ready for this event, are obviously excited. Are they always completely aware of the condition of their horse?
Well, hopefully, it's growing pains, and that's what they're here for. These are upcoming riders. And hopefully they're getting some instruction to check and see if their horse is sound enough to go. And that's what we're hoping on.
On Friday, we had our dressage competition. And let's take a look at three of the top rides from that day. First here we have Annie Creeters and Welton Aland.
This is a horse, a really nice young rider horse. He's had some mileage with a former USET rider, Grant Snyman, before this young lady bought him. A good horse to get mileage on. You can see he's a very steady guy, very consistent. And that's one of the things the judges are looking for, is the fluidness, the suppleness, the elasticity, and how obedient your horse is. Now you figure these horses are probably ready to go 12 miles. And to get them to go into this dressage ring, especially with this temperature change being so cool, to get them to handle it this civil is really sometimes an art.
Well, Ralph, how big a part does dressage actually play in a three-day competition? I know a lot of people find it boring.
Well, it is not boring, believe me, when you're sitting on an animal, 1,000-pound animal, ready to run cross-country the next day. The ratio they gave us, or that we've been trained to believe in, is 3 parts dressage, 12 parts cross country, 1 part stadium. We say in a 3-day, if you can be within 15 to 20 points of the leader and it's a tough enough cross country, the cross country horse will rise to the top. And that's what, you know, we believe in and go to work.
Well, this was our leader after dressage, Virginia Jenkins and Talisman, with a 46.8. And why don't we take a look at the rest of the top riders after dressage. We see that in second place was Tears of Eden and Kippers. Annie Creeders followed in third with Welton Alon. Caroline Atherholt in Living Color. Karen Nutt on Bijou. Sarah Rudd and Bingo. And Sean Cracker with Leroy. Those two were tied for sixth place. And as we take a look at the rest of the 28 starters that we had beginning this competition, the word is that the first competitors are now actually starting to come into the vet box. What happens in the vet box, Ralph?
Well, this is our pit stop. We have a good pit crew. You can see the veterinarians are taking their temperatures, checking their pulse, respiration, and we as riders are organizing our final game plan.
Here's Mark Combs.
What's the footing look like out there?
Steeplechase is getting the top skin torn, but the bottom layer is staying pretty firm and all. I think a lot of people are going a little slow this morning. You get the crazy young riders out there in a little while, we'll tear them up.
What do you think young riders should be particularly paying attention to out there?
They gave us good combinations out there. They put a couple combinations out there to make us think and kind of take the gamble here, you know. They want people to egg it on, see if they can get away with it or not. It's going to ask a lot of these younger ones that are up here doing the first 3-day. I think a lot of them are going to get a little eager, figure they can do it, and hopefully they'll be able to get away with it, but, I mean, you know how it goes, unpredictable.
We'll be back with all the excitement of Phase D, the cross country, right after this. Welcome back to Buchart Farms in Chatsworth, North Georgia. And our first rider is out on course and over the first 2 fences. This is Sean Crocker aboard Leroy.
Well, this will be a very good horse, Paul, to watch. He's got a lot of mileage with a different rider, but he's had a lot of mileage at the upper levels. He's a solid citizen. So as a rider, this would be a good one to watch, because if this older horse starts to peek and look at some things, then you know with your greener horses you're going to have to ride a little bit stronger. He was really handy there, and that was after a long pull up a hill. You have a little bit of terrain here to deal with. You know, the roads and tracks was very flat, the steeplechase was flat, but you can see here they're making off of a turn, now they're going down a really steep incline, and then boom, right to these bounce banks. Little weak there. You can see what happened there. It's deceptive. You feel like you're getting run off with because gravity's taking a hold of you going down the hill, and a lot of your green riders are going to be trying to hold back.
All right, now he gives them the 10 cc's of impulsion there. Well, it may have been a little late, but that refusal will cost him 20 penalty points, but hopefully a little inspiration for the rest of the course. Starting out here is Stacy Pierce on Golden Danita, and she's over the first fence.
This is a combination relatively new to the sport. You can see there's a really cute little jumper. Well over that fence. It's very important, Paul, to get your first 3 fences, to get them up on their feet. These are very formidable tables coming up. This sets the tone of the course.
So these first 3 fences are basically just to get them going until the first question is asked at these tables.
Correct. This is the first big effort. You have to make a decision. You see, she was a little sticky there and in deep. She made the decision a little bit late to add. Okay, the other horse you saw left the stride out. So that's your first test to let you know what you're sitting on, whether you're going to have to get the 10 cc's of impulsion and start to work, or whether you're still, you know, your arms are burning from the horse pulling on you.
All right, Sean Cracker and Leroy through the water, and here they come to the corner option.
The horse was very cautious and careful there. You'd like to see the rider get a little more fire under this horse, let him know early in the course that he's a little slow. That's probably why he's taking the longer option here. Footing looks a little deep there on the turn, but it was well balanced.
All right, yeah, we did have a lot of rain on Wednesday several days ago, and well, hopefully it's going to hold up throughout the day.
The interesting thing, Paul, about this footing is a lot of it is turf laid upon the ground, okay, upon the clay. So it's sometimes it's like stepping on a carpet, you know, it punches a little bit away from you. This fence, because of the addition of the tables, you saw this horse add up there. And you can see her go to the stick there. That was a very good move. This horse had been jumping a little airy and a little cautious. He needed that at the moment. Well done there.
So even though these riders have all actually walked the course several times, they're constantly making adjustments throughout.
Well, you have to take a reading. That's the exciting part of this sport. It's instinctive riding, a lot of it. We walk this course three times. You take a reading on how your horse is jumping, and then accordingly, if they're jumping great, you go the fast ways and edge it out. If they're jumping a little sticky or they need a little bit of air, then you start taking longer options to get them home. And this is the educational process for these young riders.
Well, she had a couple of nice big jumps over those last two fences. Tears of Eden and Kipper is now on course, and they're over the first two.
Yeah, and this rider's got a little pressure. She's got a shot of possibly winning this. There's been some problems out there, some time penalties, not a lot of people getting home. She's sitting second after dressage. I mean, this is when you want to start scrumping and riding by the seat of your britches a little. Oh! That's a little bit of that backseat bandit syndrome. Now, you can see that those tables held that horse, and he got in there, he stalled. The rider froze and didn't kick. She owes that horse one.
Left the seat of her britches. Now, here's Stacy Pierce through the water, and it looks like she's getting it together now.
This horse is just hunting around like a Sunday hack. This looks like a really nice, honest little horse. Little twist there, and a bobble there. You can see the turf going away. This is what we were talking about. You were talking about earlier. A glance off, and she jumps the fence backwards.
Oh, what an amazing job for the horse to stay on its feet. Now, I guess a little out of control, not knowing what's going on. Jumped the fence backwards. What happens in a situation like that, Ralph?
Well, it's a very gray area. I have a feeling they're going to eliminate this girl for jumping a fence backwards. It's an AB complex, and it's a shame. She was just out of control at the ends of the reins. The little horse knew one thing. He's a good cross-country horse. He knew if she points him there, he's to get to the other side. And when he glanced off of that, he was only looking to jump. So it's a tough break for that combination.
Well, she's over fence 14. She hasn't been stopped yet. And here we have a stop with Tears of Eden, who was in second place, picking up 20 there at the Narrow Straits.
Well, I think she, you know, we all need a little bit of eventing luck. And I think she called on it at those tables. And that's mileage. When you have an awkward moment like that, you've got to give the horse a little bit of a kick and a click and a pat on the neck at the same time and put some air back in their sails. And, you know, to come right down to this, you know, ramp jumping into space and not get after her, the mare was confused. She didn't know whether she was jumping into space or over another wide one. She was very smart here to take the long option, Paul.
Yeah, obviously having a little trouble, you know, trying just to get around now, I would assume, taking the long option at the steps.
And that's what we were talking about earlier. These riders have to make a decision. The mare's ears are pricked. You know, I think she's just a little behind the rider's leg. They need to bite the bullet a little bit.
All right, here we have Sean Crocker coming to the backside of the course now after a long gallop through the woods and on the backside. We had a coffin back there, and here they are over the dry dock and coming to a double corner option.
Well, that dry dock thing is a psychological problem because there's a big water ditch underneath it. This horse looks like now they're both in gear. He jumps those double corners relatively easy and still galloping very quiet and ears pricked.
All right, well, here comes Sean Crocker to the final two fences. And are the final fences anything like the first few where, you know, they're kind of bringing them back down now after the majority of questions have been asked?
Your good course designers try to put a little bit more of a ramp or slope to the jumps and get you home. Now, that last fence, the Palisade jumping into space, keeps you honest. It keeps the riders from running them off their feet. The last fence, as you can see, has a nice slope, good brush, good fence to gallop to even on a tired horse. It's amazing. Oh, she's in trouble right here.
Well, Tears of Eden having a stop here at the first part of the water. Obviously, she's been having some problems at the start of the course, and it looks as though she's opting to retire. And while she was standing in second, that's going to move some other people up.
Well, and there's, you know, we all have a little CIA system, and we have people out there looking. It'll get back to the 10-minute veterinarian box that, you know, the girl that's leading the dressage will know that now the second place rider's out of the contention. She might be able to have a couple more time penalties.
All right, this is Jamie Cathy and Bon Heather, and they're over the coops there and coming to the Narrow Straits.
Oh, yes, I mean, a little bit loosened attack there. You know, she jumped those two big tables brilliantly. I mean, had some zip, and she got just jumped out of the tack there. And again, that's what course designers play with you, is they'll give you two big, bold galloping fences like that, and then that was a bit of a compression exercise, and she never took a tug. That's wonderful things about these young riders is sometimes, you know, they just hook down there and let it fly.
Well, it looks as though, you know, from the start of the competition here, we've got a lot of good acrobatics going around. You know, people are keeping their feet, horses are keeping their feet, and, you know, they're making some decisions to help get them around, like these steps here with the longer option.
Well, you know, I think it jostled her a little bit more than the horse, and I think she was smart to take the long option there because she definitely, that was sort of the, what we call in God we trust to stay on that horse.
All right, well, Virginia Jenkins and Talisman are about to start off. Let's get the dogs out of the way and bring her up to the brush and log at number one.
See that wonderful first fence, big roll to it, telephone pole, puts you on your feet. Second fence, you're going up a gradient, so that holds them. It puts the horses on their hind end. Really nice beginning.
Jamie Cathy and Bon Heather down to the water, and it looks as though they're doing all right down the way.
Oh, she's lost her pedal again. You can see she was so worried about getting her stirrup on, raising her heel on that, she didn't give the horse any focal point. She was worried about losing her stirrup on a little. Again, it goes back to looseness in the tack. Now, one good thing about these videos, when they look at these and study them, you know, this girl will make sure she gets herself fitter for the next competition. Because look at that. See right there. Again, caught in the back seat, lost another stirrup arm. A lot of that's first-time three-day-itis. A little bit of nerves here.
Yeah, she's getting tossed around a little bit. But, yes, it does look like the horse was willing. She came into the water. It seemed okay. Another slip here at the corner.
Well, see, now where will it get back? Now, they'll either change. We put different caulks in the horse's shoes. Okay, or studs, as we call them. And so word will get back, and they'll make a decision whether to put in bigger studs or bigger caulks or whether they need to come at that complex slower.
All right, here comes Virginia Jenkins, our leader, and she's fine here through the narrow straights and approaching the step-up option.
Well, with her being the leader, she's gotten enough reports now that she knows. A little bit of a weak ride there. That horse was very clever there. She knows now what she has to do. She knows how the course is riding. Enough feedback has come back to her, so she can start to edge it a little bit.
So the game plan is constantly changing, even though you may have a set plan in your mind when you're in the box.
Exactly, and that was an awkward jump before the water. She better start going to this, a little bit of stick and growl at him here to get him in front of her leg. See her tapping there? That was a very smart move. It'll put him back in gear. Each fence has an influence, and you got to realize these horses have gone 6 miles before this.
Now here's Annie Creeters and Welton Alon. She was third after the dressage, and so far, through the first six fences, seems to be doing okay.
She's very clever there, the horse. He uses his front legs real well. Now she's got to open him up a little bit to get over this. A little weak and offline. That is a directional test. That's the way they're building these courses now, Paul, so nobody gets caught, you know, or hurt. She just missed her direction, so she had a glance off. Now, it'll be interesting to see how they judge that because she presented him a couple times to that vertical on the side. That'll be up to the fence judge's decision there.
Mm-hmm. The third element of those steps there is very narrow, and it is very hard to hold your horse towards something that small.
Well, exactly, and especially when you think of, oh, no, a glance off there. I think this is more rider fatigue here. She's not being able to help the horse. We saw him jumping acrobatic feats early. It looks like she's going to retire also, Paul.
Yeah, this was Jamie Cathy, and yeah, she has just dismounted and will be retiring at fence 17. Virginia Jenkins and Talisman, on the other hand, is the first to go straight over the corner.
Well, obviously she likes the way this horse is jumping. She knows him real well, and he made it look like a very easy effort over that corner, and that's a substantial fence.
All right, so you think she's got his attention now.
Yeah, I think you're going to see this rider, unless something dramatically changed, she's going to go the fast route. She's taking a shot to win this thing.
All right, this is Aaron Thompson and Winds of Time, and they're well underway. Coming to the water, Annie Creeters and Welton Alon.
A little bit more forward in her position than you'd like to see going in the water, because a lot of times, Paul, when you jump in the water, it has a slowing up effect. And she was a little bit further in the tack, but he's jumping it great.
All right, yeah, I've heard, a lot of people more concerned about their way into the water instead of their way out.
Exactly, and with this 9-foot distance, you've had a little bit of a prep for those first banks. That's only 9 feet, and you figure the horse's natural stride is 12 feet. So they know when they jump into the water, if their horse handled that 9 feet pretty well, then they know about what speed they need to come out of the water.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, at the corner option, Virginia Jenkins here, who we see coming to the double corners, seem to have, you know, a pretty easy time going the straight way, where everyone else has been taking the option, and it seems like they're all losing their footing.
Losing the footing, the ground goes away from you, as you had pointed out earlier, a lot of rain. I think it's just, oh, she took a gamble there, ran right under that jump. But that's why it's a staircase. It has a ramp. A lot of people want to get around their first 3-day. They hear that people aren't successful, so they're asking just to get around.
We'll be back to Bouchard Farms with the National Young Riders Championships after this.
How's everything shaping up?
Pretty good. The course is doing good. The kids are all taking it in the stride.
She's going out.
It's good. It's a nice day to work the vet box because, you know, you're not having to splash a lot of water on them. Your biggest worry really is them tying up in weather like this. And I haven't seen anything in any kind of distress yet, so I guess everybody's doing it right.
All right, well, thank you, Andy. It sounds like everyone is coming into the vet box in pretty good shape. And here we are with Aaron Thompson and Winds of Time.
This horse looks like he's a little bit, look at him, making a bid for the jump. That's what I like to see a cross-country horse do. He's very exuberant. Look, he's not the best broke yet in the bridle, as we call it, but he's very forward, and that's what you want for cross-country.
All right, well, he seemed to be tugging on his head a lot as he came down to that elephant trap.
Yeah, I have a feeling that this horse is really, oh, this is a very forward horse, but the rider should not be tilting forward going into water. This is the nice thing about this water jump. It's forgiving enough to educate the riders. That boy will remember not to jump ahead at the next water jump.
All right, here we have on course Mark Combs and Solferino. And Mark is making a big day as Young Rider of the Year.
He's probably the most seasoned young rider we have because he had that other horse, that Solomon, that he has run a lot of advance. So, you know, yes, this is a different horse, and you can see add up the strides there. He'll be working to get around. He knows exactly what he has to do, but he has the mileage to do it.
All right, here comes Annie Creeters and Welton Alon to the double corner.
Horse is still jumping really well, showing the mileage. It was a shame for that one little mistake. She looks like she's still got a lot of gas in the tank.
All right, yeah, a question on that. How come it seems as everyone's having no problems with the double corner, but everyone's taking the option at the single corner option?
Well, that's a good question, Paul. The single corner is very narrow. It's right after the water complex, and it's bigger and airier looking. So your margin of error is more narrow. By the point of the double corners, they're very forgiving, very inviting. You're heading home. The horses are in a rhythm. You've just had two nice big docks to gallop them over and get them pumped up. And so I think that's why more of the riders are trying those.
All right. Mark Combs the long way through the steps. He had mentioned earlier that he was going to take some of the longer routes because of the inexperience of this horse.
When you do that, when you walk your course, you try to, if you're organizing that you're going to take the long routes, you try to figure out how many seconds you're losing, and then you make sure your horse is in condition enough to gallop faster in between. Okay, the young riders are going at 520 meters per minute. So Mark will have to gallop between fences sometimes at 550 or 570 to make up the seconds that he's lost taking the long options.
Yeah, the long option at the steps does take considerably longer. Stephanie Moss and Brumby over the second fence and here at the coops.
This horse is jumping like a little rubber ball. See him fire off the ground. This horse is doing it with authority. It's always exciting to watch an upcoming horse and rider with this kind of exuberance. Really good over that. Clever pat at the ground. Look at this horse's expression. He listened to his rider there. Now look at him. He's focused, locked on. Boom. Boom, a lot of push from behind, and away they go.
Very nice, straight up through the steps. Aaron Thompson down out of the woods and coming to the dry dock.
He looks like, Paul, he's still got a lot of horse left. The horse fired over that dry dock real easy. It looks like he's setting up to do the double corners.
Yeah, it seemed as if he was having a little bit of balance problems earlier as he came to the water. Obviously no problems on the backside of the course.
Well, the horses have a tendency to get smoothed out. The riders, this course is very busy early. If you think about it, you have the two tables, then you have the ramp, then you have the banks, then you only have two fences, and you go to the water complex, followed by a turning complex. So they really throw a lot at you early. Then they settle off of you on the backside. So now see the riders in a rhythm now. They're settled in, the horse is settled, you're not picking on them. So you have time to get a horse like this settled into the bridle.
All right, well, here he comes, the last fence. A little deceiving maybe with the brush and the curvature to that?
A little bit, but a nice fence to ride to. It still keeps the horse honest. And you need a horse, a fence like that towards the end, because a lot of these young riders get pumped and they start edging it out, and it's, LaGoff used to say, no, hi, mommy, hi, daddy, at the last jumper. That's when you turn over. And that's why they put that last fence in. This is surprising, Paul, that she's taking the long option here. The way this horse is firing and jumping, I'd been inclined to just go down there and smoke that corner.
Yeah, she looked pretty sweet through the water, just, in, out.
Yeah, I mean, this horse is really just, and look how brave he is. In fact, he's a little too brave there, but that's when you got to call on scope. That horse had plenty of talent to do that. That's something she's going to have to remember.
All right, they can't see the other side. They can't see the ground after that little coop up there on top of the hill.
Correct, and you're going uphill. A horse feels less secure jumping uphill because it makes its hind end weaker, okay, the way the ground is. And she's got to be aware next time you don't want to leave off to something that wide, that long. Little miss of direction here. Yep, and you can see the worst scenario is she had a run out. Nobody got hurt, which is important. Now she's got to go figure out. That's why we walked the course three times. What's her option? Where can she get back over? She's already jumped two elements. She has one more element to do. And you can see she's going to turn and take the long approach. But there was a directional thing. Watch the way this horse carries his head and neck. He's not totally, the other horse we just saw, the chestnut, his ears are pricked. He's locked on about 3-4 out. This horse is still worried about the rider's hands. That's something that, her and her trainer are going to have to work out.
All right, well, here is Mark Combs to the double corner.
So if this horse is green, like Mark was saying, and he's working all the long routes, if he went to the double corners, obviously he feels they're straightforward. Now, that was a bit of a risk. You heard the way the horse was breathing, and that was a really big effort at that jump. Mark took a bit of an unnecessary gamble there.
Did he leave a little early on that?
Or? That's correct, Paul. He stood way back off of that. And when you get that late in the course, the horse's reflexes are slower. They're like runners. They don't want to lengthen or shorten from that stride. And that's a bit of a risk.
All right. Sarah Rudd and Bingo here. It's seeming like they're getting it back together. And it looks as though she's going to take the option also here at 13.
Yeah. And you see, again, it's just that's still that same thing of, the horse just needs the, and this is where you're down at this level, is to get together with these animals and figure them out. She's just got to start being a little bit more willing to let go of this horse's face and let him stretch and, find out what we, this is why we feed him, to take care of us from time to time.
Well, trust does play a big part in this sport. You got to believe in your horse, and your horse does have to believe in you.
And that's what you're here for, starting at this level, is to blow out those cobwebs and come to a partnership, because it is a partnership. That's what's unique in our sport. Look at this horse. This is what I like to see, a horse still fresh and full of run.
Well, let's hear what Mark Combs had to say about his go.
Okay, Mark, tell me the story.
Well, like I told you earlier, man, a little early to take the gambles. A lot of horses went out there, a lot of experienced horses went out there with inexperienced riders, weren't getting the job done. My idea to get around and played safe and stay on my dressage score and see what happens tomorrow. Worked and had to run a little harder than other people, but got the jumps done. Didn't get the 20 points everybody else was getting, so hopefully it moved me up a couple places, or if it doesn't, I'm still within a good reach of getting something decent out of this. So,
why do you do it?
Excuse me?
Why do you do it?
Why do I do it? Adrenaline, thrill.
All right, well, here we have Karen Nutt and Bijou well underway coming to the narrow straights at 6.
Well, let's see if she can get an adrenaline thrill. Cross country is you either come off of it really pumped or it's the longest day of your life out there. When things are going well, it definitely is adrenaline pump. Oh, and you can see she got thrown a little bit forward there, but that's cross country riding.
Jennifer Walton in Coastal now over the first, and her sister Jill was in Barcelona this past summer.
Yeah, she was the highest placed American in her first really big international competition. Got to be really excited.
Well, hopefully it's in the bloodlines, both with their horses and her, and she'll have a nice ride. She comes up to number 3, and no problems there.
Now, the horse, you can see, jumped that very casual. He didn't really respect it and hold on it. Obviously, he's ready for the bigger jumps.
All right, this is Sarah Rudd and Bingo coming to the double corner, and it looks as though we have our first rider taking this long option here.
And that is exactly what it is called, a long option. There's a lot of seconds wasted here. I'll bet you it's 10 to 15 seconds anyway. I don't understand it. The horse looked like he was jumping fine. Something must have happened on the backside to make her want to go this long route. Sometimes what young riders feel, Paul, towards the end of a course, is the horses don't steer as well. And so that's why I usually, if you have nice easy corners, take that shot, because you can't turn them anyway.
All right, Karen Nutt through the water, Bijou, and coming down to the corner option and straight over that.
Yeah, and you can see that, I mean, he was not really accurately placed there, and that corner still rode. Everyone we've seen has jumped over that corner fine.
No slips and slides anyway.
Oh, and another one that left. They're going to learn how to ride those uphill fences.
All right, well, we'll be back to Bucard Farms in North Georgia. Welcome back to Bucard Farms in Chatsworth, North Georgia, and here we have Jennifer Walton in Coastal over the sixth fence and coming down to the step-up option.
Oh, and he's a little offline, a little wobbly there. This horse gallops across the ground really well. Real easy through the water. You see, a lot of times when riders get pitched forward like that, if you watch the way this horse uses his hind end, he flipped it up in the air going in. Riders aren't used to that, okay? That's why usually going in the water, we assume a little bit more of a back seat, pushing our pedals in front of us. That horse was not in gear. There's 20.
Yeah, this is Michelle Bailey and Gemstone. We're just underway. We're at the fourth fence, and you had nothing to do with that one.
Well, and as a rider, what you have to learn, you've made a mistake, okay? So you have to let the horse know real quick, you know, that he made a mistake. It goes back to that 10 cc's of impulsion, a slap of the stick, a little kick in the stomach, and say, hey, come on, we've got to get in gear here. You can see she's just turning, representing, and then she makes the horse work twice as hard the second time. That she's got a long trip ahead of her.
Well, the second part of that fence was, you know, exactly like the first. What, and she was able to get him over after a second attempt. What caused the stop at the second part?
Coming up the hill, the first three fences are very vertical, and the fourth fence is those two big spread fences. They have width to them, and she did not ride aggressive or strong enough to get across the width, and the horse knew it.
All right, well, she's come to her third refusal at her third fence in a row, and a second one now. And, it looks as if she's going to call it quits right here.
Well, she's smart. You know, he's a nice-looking horse, and it's time to go back, evaluate, study what went wrong, get some help, and, there'll be another competition.
All right, Jennifer Walton in Coastal, another rider taking the long option here at the corner. And how much space do they have to work with here at something like this? I know I've seen the penalty markers out there.
Well, they made this one what we call, Paul, a continuous penalty zone. So they widened it past the normal 20 meters. So they have a little more room to work with. She used about all of it right there. So, you know, you have to watch that when you walk the courses.
All right. So in a normal fence, we have 20 meters in front and back and 10 to the side?
Correct.
All right, this is Michael Sigman and Quail, and it looks as though he's going to take the long way here at the steps.
This looks like a really kind horse. He's just jumping quiet, soft. This must be their, you know, one of their first 3 days, and he opted now to just go around and get clean.
Well, it looked like, that may have helped the time there, taking a little hop at the second step where others have wound all the way around.
Well, obviously they've gotten some reading now, so they know they can take some long options and still get across the time.
Dad, what's your plan right now? What's it looking like?
Well, he can jump really green, and he has his good days and his bad days, and I guess depending on how he feels over the first three or four fences, I'll pretty much decide whether I take the long options or the short options.
All right, well, here is Darla Price underway and Sacre Coeur. And, well...
Well, I tell you, you can see, I like a young rider like that. She's had a little bit of mileage, and you see she has a plan. She's going to see how the first few tests work out for her, and then she'll decide whether she wants the fast options or not. That's smart riding.
All right, the constant decision-making of Phase D. Jennifer Walton in Coastal through the double corner.
That horse still looks like he's got a lot left. You can see he still didn't want to really compress and come back. Oh, what a kind horse. Look at this horse. He looks like he's out for a Sunday hack.
All right, well, a little loss of balance on the way in, near our right on the way out, coming to the straight route through the corner.
Oh, man, I'll tell you. And, Paul, that was without really any inspiration from the rider, and this horse just went to the base and played over top of that thing.
A little bit of hippity hop there, and he's over 14.
I'll tell you that he just earned his bag of carrots.
Darla Price seeming to do all right here at number 6, coming to the stairs.
Well, let's see if she goes. The horse is jumping well. I'd be surprised if she doesn't go to fast route. Oh, you hear a good and patchy. Knew he got offline. Now, he could have been, bad and scooted out the left, but, you know, he was an honest guy. That's why she gave him encouragement and pet him. I like seeing that.
A little misdirection, but very willing. And Nan Martin and Romani over 4 and 5.
A little offline there and took a hind rub. You know, she's got to start getting a little more accurate.
All right, here we have Michael Sigman and Quail at the double corners. Seems like no problem there.
Now, this horse is really kind. You can see no spurs. He just pricks his ears, goes and does his job. That's a nice horse.
All right, Darla Price and Sacre Coeur to the water.
And she's finding out. You know, she plans on moving this horse up next year, so she's taking a reading how, you know, he jumped the water. Oh, a little off direction there.
All right, was it? Do you think that was a last-minute decision, or you know, did she have a little bit of a problem on her approach?
Well, you know, it was obvious she wasn't going to go to the corner. She probably changed her mind after the water, but I think you're right. She missed her panel and then realized she had to come back at it. So I think it was a rider error.
And Nan Martin, Romani, and straight up, but not so straight.
Now, see, she should have taken a reading. If you think back at the table, she jumped way to the left side of that table. So this horse was giving an indication he was jumping to the left side. So she should have planned that and jumped the right sides coming up the bank so she wouldn't have had the run out that she did.
Yeah, it looked like as though she had a little loss of balance at those coops also.
Well, and that's true. And this is where the fitness of the rider comes in also. That's part of the homework you have to do.
All right, here we have Hannah Whitehouse and Pomfrey coming up to the coops at 4.
Good aggressive ride there. You know, and that's what you have to do early on. You know, get the rhythm. Let them know what they're out for, and then you can start to settle.
All right, Darla Price, a little one-handed over the dry dock, trying to get it back together, or setting herself up for the double corner.
Yeah, the British sort of taught us that move. That's called hailing a taxi, and we use that for balance when we get caught behind. You can see towards the end of the course, this horse is a little less focused, okay? And that's what they have to learn. They have to learn how to go when they're a little bit tired. Wow, this is the first time we've seen this, Paul.
All right, yeah, Nan Martin taking the long route here at the water.
So obviously she felt that her horse must be a little bit green for that type of water, so she's opting to take what we call the long way or the scenic route.
All right, and she was there through there, no problem. And after the long route at the water, a straight over the corner.
Now, but interesting enough, that was not that, that was a pretty smart move. If you think the horse was jumping left, the corner was set up so that the only place you could run out was to the right. So that corner held him in. So that was a pretty smart move, but I am surprised she took that after the long approach through the water.
All right, here comes Hannah Whitehouse and Pomfrey to 6, the narrow straights. Sven seems to have been riding all right throughout the day.
Yeah, and that's a jumping. If you look at it from the front, it's deceptive from the way we're looking at it. But from the front, the horse really looks like he's jumping into space. Oh, and she takes the flag.
All right, a little too narrow there. Well, we'll get our course back together. In the meantime, here's Corey Tucker in the box.
How are you doing today?
All right, we took a little bit of a spill, but...
Nothing major?
No, we just took a little mudslide.
Where at?
What?
Where?
Steeplechase.
Got a little slick out there, I understand.
Yep, definitely.
Yeah, what's your plan here for D?
Well, I don't know. I mean, we have nothing to lose, so we might as well.
You're going for the straight through.
Well, we'll just see. He's new at all this, so we'll see how he is.
But what's your plan?
I don't have a plan. We'll take one step at a time.
Okay, all right.
All right, well, Corey Tucker seems to know what's ahead of her. As we see Nan Martin and Romani coming to the double corners.
You see this horse is still drifting out left. She had to really grab that right rein. And that's something, Paul, you always keep in the back of your mind. Whatever your horse's natural instinct is, when they get tired towards the end of the course, they're always going to go that way. And you have to be aware of that and plan that, you know, in your strategy towards the end of a course.
Well, yeah, she made that adjustment at the water, so it seems like, yeah, she is pretty familiar with the conditions.
Exactly, and this is what you do during the winter when you're schooling, is try to correct that problem.
All right, Corey Tucker and Patrick getting set out of the box and on the move towards the first and here over the second.
Well, this will see how tough this little kid is because she's had a slip on steeplechase. You know, now we got to see she's got to shake that off. This is serious now. She can't be thinking about her fall. I would have liked to heard her say that she had a plan, but we'll see her freewheeled out here, I guess.
All right, Hannah Whitehouse and Pomfrey. It looks like they're still on the move, chugging right along.
Yeah, this horse is jumping really well. Oh, and a big leap over that corner. Almost left her in the back seat.
All right, she's approaching the coop on top of the hill, number 14, the hen house. And, yeah, you were talking about airiness. He's getting up there.
Yeah, and that's why we call that type of fence, Paul, fly fence. You can just attack that thing and let him get right to it. And, you know, that's a fence you need after you've done a water in a corner. You need that type of fence as a breather to build the heart back up in the horse and the rider.
All right, well, it looks as though Corey here is going to at least attempt the straight
ride. Oh, routes. A little weak ride there. Oh, and she gets left in the back, a little loose in the tack here. She's got to start tightening up.
Aaron Moore and Truckabuck, and he's trucking over 4 and 5.
Oh, man, she did smoke that, man. I mean, she really took a gamble early in the game. But again, you know, these kids, they know their horses, and she was willing to take that shot. My hat's off to her.
All right, well, here's Hannah Whitehouse coming to the double corner.
Oh, I'll tell you, 3 strides there, Paul. Most everybody has been doing the 2. I think she just got picking too much. You know, she felt him a little heavy in her hands, and she misinterpreted that. Up here we go. We're at the ends of the reins here.
And in flight.
Oh, man, oh, man. I tell you, this girl's using all of this saddle.
Holy cow.
I'll tell you, a hot bath tonight will really help this girl out.
All right. Well, she can trim back a few of the trees while she's up in the air here and approaching number 14. And Corey Tucker and Patrick having a hell of a ride, taking it as it comes.
I'll tell you what now, she is having a ride. This horse is really running strong.
And there she goes. We'll bypass part C. Okay, she's coming back here for the third half.
She just, you know, she got locked on, and just this horse was so fast up there. He's big and she's small, and he just had no room to go. And she's a little disoriented right now, as you can see.
All right. Well, that was very good of the horse taking that third element there sideways.
Yeah, and she's giving him a little encouragement. I think this is a great name for an event horse, huh? I mean, I love this name.
Yeah, well, she is trucking on Truckabuck. And here's Christina Pappas.
A little weak there. She was smart to go to the stick there. What's deceptive is the first 3 fences are verticals. All right, and they get the horse holding. And then you come to these wide ones, and she didn't change anything. And the horse thought it was a vertical and left a little long. Oh, she got pitched forward there. Took a little mane in her teeth there, Paul.
All right, well, that was Aaron Moore. And
oh, and she runs past the corner. We're having control problems here. I don't know whether the girl's just locked up into her first event or whether that she doesn't have enough bridle on this big horse. But, I mean, he's a good jumper. She just missed her line, Paul.
Yeah, she wanted to go the straight route, and blowing right by it, has had to think about it.
And she's having trouble making this turn.
And it brings back what we were talking about earlier with the penalty zones, and I guess she's stayed within the penalty flag.
Well, she, you know, they have a thing, Paul, where they say going past the plane of offense, and that's going to be a tight call because she did go past the plane of that second element before coming back. That's going to be a judgmental call.
All right, here's Corey Tucker at the double corner.
And see, a little weak ride there. You know, this girl's still a little bit loose in the tack. She's going to have to go home and evaluate that. She needed a good aggressive ride.
All right, here's Christina Pappas again and MJM Nadezda. And, you know, it looks like, you know, this horse is a lot smaller than the rest of them we've been looking at.
Well that's right, Paul. The Arabian breed tends to produce smaller horses. But, you know, that's the interesting thing about this sport is any breed or horse can compete in it if they're brave enough.
Well, let's go back to the box with Hannah Whitehouse.
I don't think I've seen a smile that big on ever.
Ever? Oh, I'm sure somewhere along the line. But you can't not smile when he was that good. Just can't. He was really good.
Okay, congratulations, Amy.
Well, thank you very
Learned
much.
Every bit of it.
Thank you. We're finished. Yay!
All right, well, Hannah Whitehouse obviously happy about bringing her endurance day to an end. Kelly Jasky and Samuel Gwiffy with a kind of a crazy ride over the fence, too, there.
Well, that's a little bit what we call a miss. You know, the horse ran underneath it. She jumped ahead, and he was very – that shows the mileage of this horse. I've, you know, competed against this horse at the advanced level, and he was able to get her out of it. I don't know what she's doing here. She's circling. I don't know whether something – equipment broke or whether she feels she's out of control or – I mean, the horse looks fine.
Well, she is the last competitor to go out in cross country, and it looks as though she's pulling up. Well, our results after endurance have Virginia Jenkins and Talisman staying on top with a clear go, and the rest of the positions have changed a bit with Karen Nutton and Bijou in second, Darla Price moving up to third with Sacre Coeur. Mark Combs, Solferino, Jennifer Walton in Coastal, Aaron Thompson, Winds of Time, and a tie for seventh between Stephanie Moss and Brumby, and Allison Ossley, New Lark Stream. We'll be back to North Georgia and the Young Riders competition after this. Welcome back to Bouchard Farms in Chatsworth, North Georgia. And Ralph, I hope you got some quality Z's last night. Mine were kind of rocky. But here's the second formal vet inspection right before we can move into the stadium.
Well, I'll tell you, Paul, this is nerve-wracking. Sometimes it's better not to have Z's, so you're a little tired here. Because you come here, you've worked all these months to get in preparation for this. You went clean and fast cross-country. You're sitting in the money, and you have a ground jury telling you that they don't think your horse is ready to finish the final day. So close, and yet so far away.
Yeah, well, they must have spotted something. Safety here is of the utmost concern. We don't want any horses or riders, for that matter, getting hurt out here on the stadium course. This is Darla Price and Sacre Coeur, and they are standing third after a clear go yesterday. We saw a glimpse of the prize, the Harry T. Peters Trophy, and Ralph, you have won that at one point.
Yeah, way back many moons ago in 1973, and that started and launched me into this career, and it's been a great sport, and you know, I wouldn't go back. And you know, it's interesting to see how things have changed and how things have stayed the same. Here we're dealing with a girl sitting in third place. They're running in reverse order. She's seen a lot of them go. She knows where the tough parts are of the course. You can see this horse twisted a little bit over this. Horses come back now. They've run 10 to 11 miles. They ride a little bit different in here. And in this course particular is unique because it's in an arena. And most of your event courses are out more in an open field and a little bigger area. Things happen very, very fast in here. You're jumping out of sand footing, which tends to run a little heavier. And you, in a tight area like this as a rider, have to ride a little more step. And your horses are not reacting the way they do in a horse trial.
Yeah, and unlike all the bangs and rubs we saw in yesterday's cross country, banging and rubbing these fences will knock them down, and that's five penalties for each rail.
Correct. So now you just asked your horse to run fast yesterday and clean, and now you have to get this horse to because he jumped yesterday a little flatter and a little quicker, now you have to get his back soft and jumping up and around and being careful. So this is the complete sport.
All right. A lot more control involved here than yesterday, where we saw a lot of riders, or a few, one in particular, where they were just on the move and cruising past things.
Right. You have to start understanding your horse's stride now. There's related distances here based off of a 12-foot stride. So that's why these riders walk this course. They have to know their horse to know whether they want to add or subtract. And, oh, that horse jumped in a little aggressive. That was a very costly mistake, Paul.
Yeah, she dropped the second-to-last rail there, and there go those dreams of third place. That'll drop her all the way down to sixth place.
Well, you know, she still's had a good competition. That's the pressure, you know, that's the sport. She rode really well and kept a cool head, and you know that the horse just made a mistake and it cost her. She'll be back to challenge him again.
Yeah, there are no options on this course, unlike yesterday when you could make a decision about how you were going, try something else, maybe a little less risky jumping wise, that takes a little more time. They've all got to go the same route here today.
Correct. And these riders know the pressure's on them. They know what they have to do. They've seen enough. That horse you see got away from her there. He didn't respond. You know, and that's finding out about your horse. You never really know about yours till you've really run a three-day event. You know, you might change your warm-up program, but this is the beginning. They have to find this out now before they move them up to the intermediate or advanced level.
All right, Karen Nutt and Bijou here. She did have a clean go yesterday, which moved her up. Several riders in the top spots now. Made it through yesterday with clean rounds.
Well, and that was a beautiful ride to that spread fence, what we call an oxer. I think that last mistake she made was a wake-up call, because look how she's sitting up now for her verticals and waiting. So, you know, sometimes mistakes early in the game are a bonus, because she's starting to ride pretty slick right now.
Well, that little last combination she went to with the roll tops, how does that affect the horse's perspective?
Well, it's very narrow. Okay, and they tend to focus on the solidness, and they don't see the top rail. So, you know, I'm surprised there weren't more rails down there. You know, the horses are handling it very well, but that would be one of the bogey fences, I would think, on the course.
All right, well, with a clear round here, Karen Nutt, well, Well, put a little bit of pressure on Virginia Jenkins, who has been standing in first place throughout the whole competition. And what kind of pressures does the top rider feel with a rail, two rails in hand?
Well, I mean, she's going to feel the pressure, but obviously she's been handling it real well from dressage day on. With Karen putting a clean round, she can have a little bit of time or two rails. Now, she's seen all these horses go. The most any horse has pulled down is three rails. So the odds are in her favor. But when you go in there, I know from going in there sitting in the first place, I only had one rail. And there was a lot of pressure. But you're so concentrating and focusing on your horse and riding the course that after your first jump and you feel your horse jumping well, everything works out all right. You have a tendency to forget about that pressure.
Do you feel good throughout the whole competition if you're sitting in first place? Does that make any kind of a difference if you're on top from dressage all the way up to the stadium? Or?
Well, it's very rare. Now, see, there she's got to get in gear. That horse stalled there. He's a little bit behind her legs. See, she's got this horse is a little slower in his reactions than the last horse, so she's got to get him in gear. Get back to your question, Paul. It's usually a jinx to win the dressage because very rarely do you win the dressage and then stay on top all the way through. This girl's done a very, very good job and definitely deserves to win this. And anytime you can win it from beginning to end, it's 3 days of pressure.
Yeah, well, it looks as though she's doing a good job of correcting mistakes she makes early, as you said, here at the first fence. And yesterday on course, I remember her having a trouble right at the beginning.
Yeah, she's starting to get in gear now. They don't realize, we always say from doing the jumpers, that your first line always rides a little long because the horses aren't in gear. And she just underrode the first three fences. Now she's awake. The jitters are over with. The horse is trying to jump clean, so that's encouraging. It feeds on itself. She's getting braver now. She realizes the horse is not staring at the color. See, she gave him a little wake-up call there, and she needed it. If she hadn't have, you know, she'd had five faults.
Yeah, it looked like he hopped straight up and got the clearance for that fence.
Yeah, she just got a little reachy. Really nice over there. She can, you know, now builds up as a rider. You know, I tend to get a little more excited at this point because I know my horse is going well. He hasn't, you know, touched the jump yet. And, you know, she's sitting only with probably three fences left. And this is when you get pumped and excited because she knows she has two rails in hand, three jumps left. The odds are in your favor right now. Oh, and a little rub there, and now she's fine. One fence home. This is going to be one excited girl.
Well, she should be excited. She put in a great test in dressage, a clear endurance, and a clear stadium round. Virginia Jenkins, the 1992 preliminary three-day event national champion, winner of the Harry T. Peters Trophy. 19 years later, Ralph, after you took it home, she's going to take it home, and hopefully, you know, she'll have the kind of career that you've had with as much success.
Well, exactly. I hope to see her, you know, locking horns with me at the upper levels in the next couple of years.
All right. It's always nice to see these young riders do so well. They are the future of three-day eventing, and here we see her receiving her trophy.
This will be a day she'll always remember, whether she ever wins another big three-day or not. This will go with her for a long time.
All right, Virginia Jenkins leading the way on her honor round, as she did all weekend. But now it's a long winter ahead. What do these riders do in preparation for next year, and especially after, you know, such a great win? How do you feel after that?
Well, after about a week, the numbness will wear off, and she'll realize that, you know, what do I shoot for now? It's what the athletes call the black hole. And what they'll reevaluate their schedule. They'll plan on what events they want to run. They definitely want to upgrade. Some of these riders will go to the Young Rider Championships in Wadsworth next year. Some riders will have aspirations to start getting ready for Georgia in the Olympics. The ones that rode the older horses will be trying to pass this knowledge on to the green horses. And the other riders will be, hopefully, our next Olympians.
Well, congratulations again to Virginia Jenkins and Talisman, a fine performance throughout this weekend, and hopefully all these riders have gained valuable experience.
How do you piece it together?
I just stay very focused on what I want to do, keep my goals in mind, and just, you know, dedication, determination, that's about it, day by day.
When you went out yesterday on course, was your standing in the forefront of your mind, or something else?
No, definitely not.
I just was glad to get out of the box and get out on cross country after the last bad incident we had. But I knew he could do it. I knew that he would get around the course, and we just went out and did what we had to do.
How many 3 days is this making your experience?
This is my third.
Mm-hmm. 3 3-days, and the third one you've run away with nationwide.
Mm-hmm. Pretty exciting.
Okay. Describe the personality of your horse. What's your horse like?
Very laid back. He's very laid back. Other than that, I mean, you know, he comes through for me. His personality is very hard to determine sometimes, but he always keeps his cool, which I think helps us in the long run. Versus the thoroughbreds.
Do you have any particular goals for next year for 93?
Definitely want to do the Young Riders again. That's my ultimate goal. So we'll just shoot for that in the summer.
So you're going to basically, your concept is to get a string of 3 to 4 trophies for 3 to 4 years in a row.
Of course, why not? What's another one?
Well, once you get the first one, I'm told that the other ones can fall in line. I think you have to pay attention to your trainer.
Oh, of course. He'll keep me in line.
Okay. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Told you we'd be brief. Made it short.
Okay.
All right. Well, let's have a look at our final results. That show, once again, Virginia Jenkins and Talisman on top throughout the weekend. Winning it all here. In second place, Karen Nutt and Bijou. Mark Combs, Solferino in third. Jennifer Walton with Coastal in fourth. Aaron Thompson, Winds of Time in fifth. And Darla Price and Sacre Coeur in sixth. All right, Ralph. Well, I want to thank you for a great time. It's been a pleasure working with you. And as we take a look at Virginia Jenkins and her little celebration party, I'll let you wrap things up.
Well, I'll tell you, Paul, it's been a great weekend. Weather was cool, great for a running cross country. I'd like to have my leg around the horse doing it. It's been good working with you. Hope to do it again, and hopefully next year we can do this again, or hopefully you'll be commentating with somebody else, and I'll be knocking heads with some of these young riders.
All right, well, this has been a USEV Captain Edgar's production, and to all of you 3-day eventers, all the courage, confidence, and intensity to take you through each day. See you later.